and you're on the air with Senator Sanders.
Well, thank you, Tom. It's an honor to speak to you and Senator Sanders. Before I make my comment, I would like to appeal to listeners to please read the Moment of Truth PDF form. It's less than 70 pages, and it contains so much information that's pertinent to what Senator Sanders has been talking about as far as the draconian cuts that might be coming down the pike. And here's what I am concerned about. Washington Post says Wednesday that Senator Warners and Chambliss are out gathering other like-minded senators into their group now. They're a gang of six now. They say they're five guys or something, but whatever they call themselves today. And I take it they're getting ready to introduce that really draconian bill, which will cut $4.7 trillion, not just the $2 or $2.5 trillion. Not that I'm not concerned, along with Senator Sanders, about the Biden group. But what are your feelings, Senator Sanders? Do we not need to really get into some real proactive mode as progressive people to try to stop? These cuts are going to be really hit the middle class. If anybody will read this this proposal, the plan, the Moment of Truth, they'll see where they're taking the cuts, whether it's Social Security or tax reform.
You are absolutely right, and I think the word has not gotten out sufficiently. That's why I talk about it every week on this show. People have got to understand that our Republican friends want to devastate Medicare, basically do away with the program that we know it to be today and make it into a voucher program. The result will be inadequate health care for seniors and a lot more money coming from seniors out of pocket. Devastating cuts in Medicaid. People don't know that most of the folks, or a good number of the people who are in nursing homes in America today, are there, and those bills are being paid by Medicaid. What happens to a family if Medicaid is not there paying that nursing home bill? You're going to have to pay it, and you can't afford to do that. Pell Grants, Title I education money coming into our public schools, nutrition programs, housing. What the result will be is millions of Americans are going to find themselves in even worse financial shape than they are now because of these cuts. And Ellen is absolutely right. We've got to get the word out, and what we have to do is tell the president and the Democratic leadership, and I say this as a member of the Budget Committee, that we are not going to accept a situation in which this effort toward deficit reduction solely comes on the backs of the middle class and working families of this country. The idea that when the wealthiest people of America now are getting wealthier, corporations are not paying, in some cases, anything in taxes, that they are excluded from the deficit reduction process is totally insane. So I agree with Ellen. People have got to get involved. The president has got to be told. He has got to stand tall on this, as do the Democratic leaders.
Paul, in New York City, you're on the air with Senator Sanders.
Hi, Senator Sanders. My name is Paul, and I wanted to speak to an issue that Tom has been talking about frequently, and that's our lack of a trade policy. I was looking through the Fair Labor Standards Act of 1938 recently, researching a non-related issue, and I came across a very interesting section, Section 204E, that says the Secretary of Labor is supposed to take a look at competition in foreign markets. And if they have determined that there has been the result has been high unemployment or is likely to increase unemployment in the United States, they have to do an investigation, make determinations, and report to both the President and Congress. I don't know if the Secretary has done such a thing. I've made an information request about 5 weeks ago. I've gotten a letter stating that I basically may have to incur fees for making my request. But I was wondering if the senator is aware of any such reports that the Secretary of Labor has made, and if so, what are those determinations?
Well, Paul, there have been a number of reports and a number of studies, and some of them are quite absurd. I think the Chamber of Commerce, which strongly supports unfettered free trade, will tell you how wonderful outsourcing has been for our country. I think, Tom, some while ago I had a quote in front of me from Tom Donahue, who is the head of the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, lauding outsourcing.
They were on seminars on how to do it if you're a corporation.
Yeah. So So this is no secret. So they are obviously going to tell you all of the benefits that come from that. I think the average American understands that that's absurd. We have lost 50,000 factories in the last 10 years, millions of good-paying jobs. And what we have also seen, and this is something that is, you know, it makes a bad situation worse. We are seeing some growth in recent months in manufacturing. And the reason for that is that wages now in manufacturing in the United States are so low that in some ways it becomes, we become competitive to China, another low-wage country. So if you're paying a manufacturing worker in America $7.50 an hour at a job that used to be double or triple that, well, you know what? Maybe we'll have jobs back in this country, but you're not going to have a middle class. So, Paul, I think the answer is pretty obvious, that permanent normal trade relations with China has failed. NAFTA has failed. The president is bringing up another trade agreement soon, which I will not support. What we have got to do is demand that all of these companies, these American companies that want us to buy their products, turn on TV, they're going to tell you how desperately they want you to buy, you know, their clothing, their cars, their telephones, whatever. They've got to start building those products here in the United States. And that's, you know, that's the issue that we are working on very, very hard.
Corey, in Muncie, Indiana, you're on the air with Senator Sanders.
Hello. Thanks for taking my call. I heard a little while back that since we've actually hit the debt ceiling, that the government can point to something and say we don't have the funding for that and cut off funding. So I was wondering, can't we just do that to congressional salaries for congressmen and senators, and maybe if Republicans actually have to feel some consequences for their stances, they'll be more prone to work towards a deal?
Well, I guess you could. Yes, you can pick and choose who you're going to pay, but I think the damage will be done. But I think your point is well heard, that maybe if some of our Republican friends don't get paid, they might perceive the seriousness.
Or just cut off all highway funds to any state whose entire congressional delegation votes against raising the debt ceiling. I mean, it's... Yeah.
Well, I guess so. But the bottom line here, of course, is that not raising the debt ceiling, not paying our debts, would be a very serious problem. Yeah. On the other hand, we cannot be blackmailed by the Republicans who want horrendous cuts in turn for their support.
Sheila, in Portland, Oregon, you're on the line with Senator Sanders.
Yeah, hi there. I have two things. One we can make very quickly. The Wiener issue. I understand he was investigating Clarence Thomas and his wife and doing a lot of investigations, and that the Republicans were out to get him. That's one thing. The other thing, though, that I think is more important right now, we call lobbying lobbying. I call lobbying bribery. And that's what has to be, that's what we have to get rid of. And it'll never happen because the Congress people in Congress, they have their hands out. They're not going to bite the hand that hand that feeds them, because they want their hands to be fed by these corporations. So how can something be done to eliminate bribery? And that's what it really is. It's graft.
All right. Well, we're talking about two things, Sheila. We're talking about campaign funding. And what that's about is that a lot of these executives at large corporations have a very sophisticated way, legal, this is legal, of getting money to the candidates who support their agenda. With Citizens United, that disastrous Supreme Court decision, which has decided, people think it's so crazy it's almost absurd to repeat it, but they have decided that corporations are people, are entitled to First Amendment rights of freedom of expression, which means they can now put as much money as they want on radio and television ads without any disclosure. They can do it in secrecy. This gives corporate America even more and more power to determine what happens politically in this country. I mean, we talked about this a moment ago, and the answer, obviously, A, is to undo Citizens United, and B, to move toward public funding of elections. But as Sheila indicates, this is not going to be easy, because if, you know, you're a senator or you're a congressman who receives huge amounts of money from the wealthy and the powerful, and you get reelected with that money, you know what? You're going to continue that process. So, you know, it's going to take a strong grassroots movement to turn that around, Sheila.